It is a joy to be with one's brothers and also with one's sister. Sister Jess was a long-time companion in the formation of our catechists and missionaries. Allow me to begin where we actually began this whole institute, with the enthronement of the Word of God. Our initial pleading, Lord, make us open to your word. I think at this juncture, that will do us a lot of good. And the first text I would like to use as a platform for some initial reflections on dialogue as a way of being church, as Father Ed beautifully said. But in addition to that, as a way of being a true follower of Christ, as a spirituality, let us begin with a very well-known character in a parable in the Old Testament. A name that can, with a lot of humor, typify to us, ourselves, the church, in terms of the message we have been tasked to deliver to the world. I am referring to the book of Jonah. I have found this very fruitful to reflect upon. Precisely, we have here a God and a servant of God who seem to be going in opposite directions. So Jonah was summoned and sent to Nineveh, but immediately he reacted and quietly he took the opposite direction from Nineveh. He took a boat to go to Spain, not to tour, but to escape from the Lord. And we know what happened. Storm grew and broke out mid-ocean. And the sailors found out what was the cause of this anger of the heavens. And when they located the man, Jonah, without hesitation, they threw him out of the boat into the water. And here, that is the part that has been the focus of our attention, that we forgot the entire story. He was swallowed by a whale and eventually vomited out and landed once more on land. And then God, for the second time, sent his word to him, sending him to Nineveh. And this time, the prophet followed and bore the word of God to this great capital city of Assyria. And here, he sort of grudgingly carried out the task to deliver the word of God, the message of doom. After 40 days, the entire city will be destroyed if they do not repent. But lo and behold, the word of God took effect. The people repented. The message struck home, led by the king no less. And that made the prophet of doom so unhappy, he started complaining to God. He said, "O Lord, is this not what I said while I was still in my own country? This is why I fled at first toward Tarshish. I knew that you are a gracious and merciful God, slow to anger, abounding in kindness, repenting of punishment." Very strange that a man should be complaining that God is compassionate and merciful. But then, his conclusion from it. So now, Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. Why? He was embarrassed. He was put to shame that the doom he predicted did not materialize. Instead, the Ninevites repented and were spared. The man would rather see them dead than living because of mercy. And so he left the city and waited that his word be taken seriously, let me die. While he was there, he built a shed for himself against the scorching sun. And God, with a lot of humor, let a plant grow in order to afford him additional shelter against the heat. And Jonah delighted in the plant. But then God next sent a worm to eat at the roots so that the plant died. And the man again was so angry. He said, what's happening? That here a plant, why should it die? And then God entered into a conversation once more with his servant. Why are you angry? For the second time, God asked him. First time, because Jonah was complaining that the Ninevites repented. Second time, that the plant that delighted him should be dead the next day. And again, the man was incoherent. That's the point. God told him, you are angry, you are concerned about the plant. Why did you not have that much concern with the 120,000 human beings in that city? Why were you desirous to see them dead, destroyed, punished? And now you are making a drama about the plant? Here we have the story of verse in the person of Jonah, God's chosen servant, Israel, to be the beacon of light and hope to other peoples, but becoming so exclusivist, they have forgotten their mission. They would rather see punishment being rained down on people because of their wickedness, rather than be happy that the mercy of God should triumph. Here we have the disorientation of being concerned with secondary matters, but forgetting the primary importance of a human being before God. And here also we see how one's perception and one's preferences eventually coming into conflict with God's own plan. But at the same time, we have revealed to us, and that is why we know Jonah was not the prophet, but the author of the book, because this is actually a parable that the author has managed to deliver to us such a powerful message about the universal sovereignty of God, that all, not only the Israelites, but even the enemies of the Israelites, the Assyrians, that they are important to him. And that for God, repentance of any people is as welcome as anyone else. And that for God, the God of life, In the last analysis, it is the preservation of life and the promotion of life that counts more than any due punishment and destruction of life. This message for us remains valid. This parable is a very important point for meditation for the church. For hundreds of years, we have always considered our enemies. Yes, we were on the category of opposition. That the enemy, whether we begin with Satan, we attributed things belonging to Satan, and therefore they have no right to exist. Eventually, we started to identify who are these enemies, even within our society. The heretics, people in error, and so the church, without noticing it, had turned to be more of a prophet of doom than anything else. And it is in that context that we have seen John the 23rd, led by the Holy Spirit, calling the Second Ecumenical Council of the Vatican, precisely to let something press into the church, to reawaken in us a new consciousness. What is it that we have been sent by God to accomplish in the world? What is our mission? Why do we see enemies left and right? Why is it that we see our duty in declaring the errors, and so we have an entire list of the mistakes and errors of the world? Why do we allow ourselves to be pushed into a corner, into a ghetto, surrounded by enemies, having this xenophobia, this paralyzing fear of the other, as Father Ed described to us? If that is in the Old Testament, one text that I find personally very inspiring is a text that is seldom paid attention to, and it is with the apostle of the Gentiles, St. Paul, and that in Ephesus. Ephesus was the fourth largest city in the Roman Empire after Rome, Alexandria, Corinth. Ephesus was the next largest real metropolitan area with its own theater and all the appurtenances of then urban life. Strangely, Paul stayed there for 2 years. He never did that anywhere else. There was something that attracted him in Ephesus. It's a port city, and that is why you have commerce, and you have there all schools of thoughts, you have there all religions, and there, of course, you have one of the eight wonders of the ancient world, the Artemion, the temple of the goddess Artemis, the goddess of fertility, the goddess of life. Oh, by way of footnote, it is in this city that Mary would be declared replacing the goddess as the mother of God. Not a god herself, not a goddess, but the mother of God. In this city, Paul stayed for 2 years, and we are told something so amazing in view of Paul's enemies when we are told that for 2 years, Paul went daily. And in the lecture hall of Tyrannus, discussing with everyone and with his disciples about the way of the Lord. It's almost like the way. And about the plans of God. 2 years it was in discussion. Earlier than that, we heard that for 3 months, Paul had been debating, but these people were not ready to dialogue, and so he left them. Institute, different from Father Ed's Institute of Physiology in Tagaytay, but this is a philosophical academy, a scholar. And there for 2 years, St. Paul would daily go, they said, from 11 in the morning up to 4 in the afternoon. And he made friends. He did not convert them, but he made friends and he proclaimed the message, the way, and the plan of God. The result of that, very interesting, chapter 19 of Acts of the Apostles, when eventually a riot by the silversmiths took place, led by Demetrius, that was an economic issue. The pagan leaders themselves, the Asiarchs, those who were important public figures managing the affairs of the state, warn him, do not avoid that section of the city because they are looking for you. He dialogued with them, he made friends with them, they respected him for it, and later on, when the official calmed down, protesting mob, "Wait," he said, "do you know that these people you are looking for, the group of Paul, that they never spoke ill of our goddess? They never spoke ill of our goddess. So what are you so excited about? If you have anything against them, then let the rule of law take over." So here in the chapter 19 of the Acts, we have in the New Testament, we know less than the apostle of the Gentiles, a way of life, of being true to his mission. And it is this that I would like to pick up, and it is the proclamation of God's plan and the way.